support the motion and to thank the Premier and the Leader of the Opposition for their kind words of thanks to Senator Wright and their welcome for new Green Senator Rob Sims. Mr. President, given our different surnames, it often comes as a surprise for people to discover that Senator Penny Wright and I have been married for 24 years and lived together for over 32 years. We go back to 1983 when we studied law together at university. Over the years, Penny and I have worked on many joint projects. Bringing up three fantastic children to adulthood is one project, but establishing a new political party in our living room was another. Back in 1995, it seemed a bold project to create a new political party with only 10 members, no money, and little political experience. What we did have, however, was a vision that politics could and should work better for people, for communities, and for the planet. As anthropologist Margaret Mead said, it just needs a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens to change the world. Now, changing the world is a longer-term project, but I think that going from 10 people in Eden Hills living room to two federal senators and two state MPs in our first 15 years was a fair start. It's probably also fair to say that back in 1995, neither Senator Wright nor I particularly imagined ourselves as members of Parliament. Our first priority was our family, and a political career was a much distant thought. That's not to say that Penny wasn't involved in political campaigns. As President of the South Australian Friends of the ABC, and later as National Spokesperson, she campaigned tirelessly against federal budget cuts in the mid-1990s. She spent many hours lobbying MPs, organising rallies, coordinating submissions that ultimately resulted in millions being reinstated to the national broadcaster. As time passed and our kids grew older, Penny eventually put up her hand for pre-selection for the Greens in the 2010 federal election. Of course, it wasn't part of the plan to be hit by a car while cycling in Blackwood just a few months before the election. The campaign continued from hospital and then from a wheelchair, and Penny ultimately achieved the highest ever Greens vote in South Australia and was comfortably elected as the 95th South Australian Senator. In her 4 years in the Senate, Penny experienced the pressures but also the joys of political life. As she said in her final message to stakeholders, "I have relished the opportunity to listen carefully, support and help people in our community, and to voice the decency and compassion that reflect the Australia I am proud of. In all that I've done, I've tried to make the right decisions, even when they're hard, acting in the long-term national interest for the future." One of Penny's proudest achievements was her work on mental health, as has been said. In particular, rural mental health. Travelling throughout regional Australia, Senator Wright listened to and documented the experience of consumers, workers and family members, and compiled a report which was described by the Chair of the National Alliance for Rural and Regional Mental Health as one of the most sensible pieces of policy work that I've seen from a political party on rural mental health in the last 25 years. As Senator Wright said in her valedictory speech to the Senate, "My rural tour sums up my favourite part of the work that we do. The rewards from meeting people, hearing their hopes and fears, amplifying their voices, and being able to reflect and validate their concerns in the National Parliament. It is very good for democracy. For me, making connections, taking the risk to be real, and listening with an open heart are really the most exciting parts of being a senator." As an experienced lawyer, Senator Wright was appointed the Greens' National Legal Affairs spokesperson. In that capacity, she was a powerful advocate for human rights and access to justice. As the Premier said, in 2012, she initiated a Senate inquiry into the value of justice reinvestment approach to criminal justice in Australia to reduce our shameful rate of imprisonment for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. And she was delighted that the South Australian government agreed to trial this approach in our state. As Green spokesperson for Veterans Affairs, Senator Wright campaigned for justice and a fair go for veterans and their families. This included the often forgotten contribution of Australian peacekeepers, who have served our country continuously since 1947, with 48 of them losing their lives while serving. The names of these service men and women are now enshrined on the honour roll of the Australian War Memorial in Canberra, largely thanks to Senator Wright's advocacy. Yeah. Other service personnel that Senator Wright campaigned for included our nation's firefighters. She was instrumental in securing unanimous support for legislation in the Senate that ensured firefighters who contracted various occupational cancers were adequately cared for. We now have similar legislation in South Australia, and firefighters from various European countries have also been in contact with Senator Wright looking for support for their campaigns. As one of the spokespersons for schools, Senator Wright was in her element. In fact, if politics hadn't called, there is a strong chance that Penny would have abandoned her legal career for one in education. Such was her passion for young people and for teaching. The fact that her Senate role got her inside the classroom to talk with kids was one of her great joys. In addition to working on securing proper funding for public education and working on a more sensible approach to NAPLAN testing, Penny also initiated an annual Australian Greens Make Peace Prize for schools to remind students of the important role our country plays in peacekeeping as well as military conflict. Mr. President, normally on occasions such as this, members wish the outgoing Senator well in her future career or retirement or whatever else the future holds, and then they move on. In my case, it'll be dinner tonight, it'll be breakfast tomorrow, and it'll be many more shared adventures together over the rest of our lives. Thank you, Penny, for all that you've done for our state during your time in the Senate. You have made us all very proud. Now I'd like to add my welcome to Robert Sims as the new Green Senator for South Australia. In the years that I've known Robert, I've been impressed with his commitment to achieving results for South Australia. His stint on Adelaide City Council and as our party's state convener has shown that he understands the importance of leadership, collaboration, cooperation and consensus. Robert was the youngest elected member on the Adelaide City Council, but as his Senate colleague Sarah Hanson-Young has noted, at 31, he is much older than she was when she entered the Senate. Robert Sims was the clear choice of Greens members in South Australia to fill the vacancy left by Senator Wright's resignation. Whilst nobody quite expected a vacancy to arise so soon, there were few in our party who doubted that one day Robert would make his contribution on the national stage. Senator Sims will be sworn in next month, and he has been appointed the Greens' national spokesperson for the portfolios of higher education, LGBTI, marriage equality, and water and the Murray-Darling Basin. Whilst it doesn't often attract the headlines, work behind the scenes in a political party is vital to the strength of our democracy. During his tenure as party convener, Robert oversaw a major reorganisation of our party and a near doubling of membership over 2 years. Robert has the personality, the dedication and the skills to attract loyalty and commitment in others, as well as leading by example. Our party has never been in better shape and is full of excitement and optimism for the future. So on behalf of all Greens members and supporters, I congratulate Robert Sims on his appointment as Senator for South Australia, and I wish him every success during the remainder of this Senate term and beyond.
Well, Ms. Franks.
Thank you, Mr. President. I also rise to support the motion. I thank the Premier and Leader of the Opposition for their kind words and their support. It is a sad occasion today, but it's also a lot of joy for our Greens Party. Penny, of course, made the decision to step aside due to family illness, and so her term has turned out to be much shorter than expected. But in those short 4 years, she has packed a lot in, I'm sure you'll agree. A tireless campaign to put rural health on the map and establishing the parliamentary friends of youth mental health, promoting awareness in particular of the little known disorder of the borderline personality disorder, which my colleague Kelly Vincent and I in this place have also championed. Penny's legal background also fueled her passion for justice reinvestment and defence of the most vulnerable, and I would say her stalwart efforts to oppose the increases in the divorce fees in the family court have not gone unnoticed by those in their most vulnerable times. Penny stood with the Kangaroo Island community to protect their precious part of the world and, of course, that precious part of our state, with significant tourism and ecological importance from seismic testing and oil and gas exploration off that coast, as well as standing strong with the community of the southeast against the unconventional gas exploration in that fertile land. This week, of course, saw the observation of the International Day of Peace, something that Penny holds dear, but indeed is one of the four pillars of the Greens Party. Just last year, Penny initiated the Australian Greens Make Peace Award, and that promoted the role of the Australian peacekeepers, but it also furthered peace in our community, and I hope that that award continues as a legacy of her great work there. It has been mentioned, of course, that Penny's role in the Senate, and indeed the unanimous support of the Senate inquiry into compensation associated with cancers related to firefighters was something that she was rightly proud of and something that the state rightly took up. Penny noted when she made her last speech in the Senate, when I stand and make my last speech, I would like to think that I have contributed to making Australia a kinder, fairer place. She did that and she did it in spades. I congratulate Penny for the amount of work she has put into those short 4 years, and I know that her contribution to our party will go far into the future. It is a privilege, of course, to welcome a new Senator, and Robert Sims, who here today will begin his parliamentary career, it's a career that when I first met him as a 17-year-old, I should have known was inevitable. But of course, nothing is inevitable. And indeed, Robert is one of those rare people that not only wants to change the world, but he puts the work in to make it happen. And that is why he is our candidate, nominated and designated for the Senate position for South Australia. I've heard the phrase that a week is a long time in politics. Well, as we all know, a week is a very long time in politics. And sometimes I think that we should have it measured in dog years, age that we enter this place and the age that we leave it. But I'm sure that you will have noted that Robert Sims at 31 is quite a young man. But he's a young man with a wise head who I believe will not be aged by the burden of Parliament. I believe he will stand up and he will rise to the challenge, as he has done on the Adelaide City Council, with his diligence and his dedication and his firm commitment of the power of politics for progressive change. In the past 2 years as convener of our party, he has, as my colleague Mark noted, brought much needed reform and a real focus on one of our other pillars, which is that of grassroots democracy. He has rejuvenated and reinvigorated the party in the 21st century, and for that I thank him. Rob is, of course, the first male senator to represent the Greens from this state. And I know that brings our gender balance to exactly half as he joins Senator Sarah Hanson now from the Dillon Chamber today. I think that's an achievement that most parties would be justly proud of, and I know it's being done without quotas. But indeed, I commend Rob for his commitment to supporting women. And as a feminist, I commend him for supporting women to organise autonomously. It is something that he has evidenced through his career, whether that be in the community sector, in politics, and I'm sure he will bring that into the Senate. He, of course, starts his Senate career with three portfolios of significance to South Australia and on the national stage. That of water and the Murray-Darling Basin, and of course that is integral to the pillar that most people would associate with the Greens, ecological sustainability. But indeed, higher education will be a challenge that I know that he will relish. As a former president of the Fringe Students Association, as a long time believer in the power of education and the power of access to education to improve lives, he will take that higher education portfolio on with gusto that I look forward to seeing. That, of course, reflects our pillar of social justice, the four grand pillars. But LGBTI, I think, and LGBTI and marriage equality is where there is some special significance that Rob will step up as the first openly gay man to represent our state in the Senate. He has been a passionate advocate for equality on the grounds of sexuality and gender identity. And indeed, I thank him for first bringing the issue of the gay panic defence to my attention. And his advocacy on the work and work that he did on that indeed resourced my campaign that I brought to this Parliament. I know that that won't be where he leaves it, and I hope that as we celebrate 40 years of the decriminalisation of homosexuality in this state, that we will see the end of the gay panic defence in this state, but also with Rob in the Senate, I believe we will see marriage equality sooner rather than later. We have a proud history of gay law reform in this state, and I look forward to our state not only leading rather than lagging, but indeed Australia leading rather than lagging. With that, I commend the motion.
Are there any further speakers?